Craig's wonderful to have around and on the crew. He is trained as a traditional upholsterer. He's got all of the old school skills.
But after two decades of working together, is Craig ready for what Drew's brought him today?
I have managed to find, after much, much, much searching, the worst Chesterfield sofa in the world.
Oh, no.
Look at that.
There's nothing going for it.
When's the skip arriving?
I know. It's bad, isn't it?
First impressions of that Chesterfield, I thought it was a joke at first. I thought, there's no way he's going to be doing this. It's just filthy. I don't know where it's come from, but it's seen better days for certain.
The deep buttoned upholstery and low seat base associated with the Chesterfield style is thought to date from the 18th century. And this one is probably around 100 years old. Passed on by another dealer, right now, the sofa is unsaleable.
The state of it.
I know. When I picked the Chesterfield, I have to be honest, I was giggling away to myself thinking, Craig's going to hate me for this. Do you like this freshly gnawed and woodwormed? The rats were eating the woodworm, it's that bad. I managed to find the worst single Chesterfield sofa in the world. There isn't one that was worse unless it had been at the bottom of the sea, then brought up, set fire to and put back in the sea. You know, that was the only thing that would make it worse.
I would suggest on this, strip this right down to the frame.
Okay.
Glue, clamp the frame. This then needs all new bits of wood on it.
It's going to be a challenge, but it will be beautiful.
A well-restored vintage Chesterfield can sell for over £1,000, but it will take many hours of Craig's skilled labour to get it there.
This one is a bit of a passion project. This is basically us showing off as a crew, basically saying, you can give us the worst piece of furniture on the face of the earth and we will make something beautiful out of it. Whether we make a profit is yet to be seen.
Drew seriously needs to brush up on his English because I think he's got upholsterer and magician mixed up somewhere. And it is just, you know, every part of it. There isn't anything I can say that's positive.
The first job in this mammoth task is to strip back the decrepit upholstery and uncover what, if anything, can be salvaged.
Where's the front border off the sofa? Absolutely rotten, stinking, dirty, filthy. There's no way I could even consider even trying to use anything like that or even try and match it. The only one place for this, straight in the bin. The dirt that's coming out of this is going to be 100 years old, at least. And it could be anything. Spider poo, bits of old people, there could be urine, there could be anything on this.
Inside this sofa, there's evidence of an unconventional life.
I've just found inside it is a load of these, which are like the little, what we used to call as a kid, helicopters that come off the sycamore trees. There's loads of them inside it.
Unless he can locate some reusable material, this restoration could degenerate into a total rebuild.
When we're storing anything like this, it's always advisable to keep as much of the original as possible because collectors for any specific type of furniture always like them as authentic as possible. So there's quite a few springs I should be able to salvage off here. Maybe some of the horsehair, give it a clean, and then we should be able to use some of that.
It's not just the upholstery that's going to need a complete overhaul.
Got a piece of wood at the front that's absolutely riddled with woodworm. This corner piece has come off. The only thing holding some of these bits of wood together, I think, are the woodworm holding hands. This horsehair is absolutely filthy. I can see it now, I'm breaking it up. It's this dirt and, you know, hundreds and hundreds of years of dirt and muck in here.
Before he can use it for reupholstery, it will need cleaning.
Right, what I've got now is two tubs of warm water. I'm just going to add a bit of washing up liquid to them. Let's mix that in a bit. Perhaps I should have used some nice shampoo for the hair. Right, so I'm getting a pillowcase now with the horsehair in. The reason I've got the horsehair in the pillowcase is if I just put the horsehair straight into the water, it'll just break up and lose it all in the water. So this all keeps it in shape and in place. Right, so drain some of that dirty water off. If you don't want to get your hands dirty, always nip round to your neighbours and use their washing machine. Don't put it in your own, it's filthy. So all I'm going to do now is I'll just get this out of the pillowcases, spread it out on this sheet, wait for it to dry, and then it'll be ready to reuse. So what they used to do years ago was the horsehair would be washed, and they used to, from what I can gather, they used to spin it into like a rope sort of shape, which would give it a twist. And then when it was dry, then that would actually give the horsehair a curl. And it makes it just like a little spring.
Once the horsehair is clean and dry, Craig can attach it to the Hessian base using loose loops of flax twine.
So get it through, fluff it up, and you can see the packing starting to create the shape. I feel like I'm working in a hairdresser's here, and I've created, you know, sort of nice hairdo on this, and you can see the nice shape that's coming to this. And so it just needs a bit more working on, and it will actually look quite nice.
It's time for the final stage of the restoration of a sofa that was a complete wreck when it first arrived in his workshop.
I'm buttoning the fabric on the back now, and the way I'm doing this is I've already created a hole in the packing in the correct place where I need to go. So now I'm feeling through the fabric where that hole is, allowing the right amount of clearance on the fabric to pull down as well. So once I've got my finger in there, I'll put twine in my mouth while I get my needle in. Push the needle through. I've already put my button on the twine, thread the twine through the needle, pull that through. And while I'm pulling on the twine, I'm pressing the button to the right depth. Once that's right there, I'll just fasten this off underneath.
Covering this sofa will take many hours of labour, but as the buttons go in, the renowned diamond pattern of the Chesterfield appears, as if by magic.
Seeing this coming together is really good. Compared to what it was when it came in, it was rotten and stinking. And now it's starting to look like a proper Chesterfield, and it's been a challenge, to say the least.
Two weeks ago, Drew admitted that he'd found the worst Chesterfield in Britain. But this has first and foremost been a passion project. Though it's now worth over £1,000, it's cost many hours of skilled craftsmanship to give this once quality item a new lease of life, preserving as much as possible of the original, but with a solid frame, reconstructed upholstery, and a luxurious green velvet cover.